What does it mean to be Stoic? For the answer, you may turn to the dictionary definition of the word, a person who can endure pain or hardship without showing their feelings or complaining. Now, you may have heard this word used as an everyday adjective, that someone is just Stoic, to describe someone who handles a situation without showing too many emotions. But there is much more to the word Stoic. It's not just an adjective, it's actually a philosophy. Stoicism is a school of thought that has been around for over 2,000 years. Like lighthouses, alarm clocks, and other 3rd century BC creations, Stoicism still has a place in our lives today. You can use Stoicism as a way to address failures, obstacles, and tragedies in a way that allows you to move forward with courage and confidence. The great Stoics, including Seneca the poet, Epictetus, and Marcus Aurelius, viewed Stoicism as a way of life. The central ideas of Stoicism have given guidance to great leaders throughout world history. As we examine those ideas throughout this video, you might start to see why these ideas are so powerful, accessible, and timeless. Marcus Aurelius once said, "It's silly to try to escape other people's faults. They are inescapable. Just try to escape your own." Now, this is a central idea within Stoicism. Idea number one, if you want to think like the Stoics, the first thing you can do is examine what is and is not in your control. You must also accept that the decisions and behaviors of other people are very rarely, if ever, in your control. Let's look at this idea in the context of dating. You cannot control another person's emotions, their perceptions, or maybe who they find attractive. You could be having a nice conversation with a person, pull out all the stops, and look really good. They may still find themselves missing their ex, wanting to focus on themselves, or just not having an interest in going on a date with you. These things are not in your control. Is it worth letting yourself become angry or depressed because one person does not want to go on a date with you? Stoicism says no. You cannot control another person's thoughts. You can only control your own. Stoicism says to take control of what you can do in this situation. Maybe that's being gracious to the person and respecting their boundaries. Maybe that's reminding yourself that there are plenty of fish in the sea. You have the ability to remind yourself that one person's perception of you will not affect your ability to hold down a job, meet new people, or enjoy your life. Despite this one supposed setback or obstacle, you still have the ability to move forward. It's like that prayer, "Grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference." This prayer was actually first shared in the 1930s, centuries after the Stoics laid out this idea. Another important thing is that Stoicism is not about walking around without any emotions. Big idea number two is that it's about understanding what is behind those emotions. If you find yourself experiencing negative emotions that are leading you to make negative decisions, Stoicism encourages you to take a step out of your negative emotions and see how you can steer yourself back into a more positive, or at least a neutral, direction. Marcus Aurelius wrote, "Our life is what our thoughts make it." Are you going to allow negative thoughts to add negativity to your life, or are you willing to step outside of your negative thoughts, reframe them, and choose to live a more positive life? Stoics believed you could do this and understand that your emotions are a natural part of the human experience, but they thought that the key is to understand what makes you feel certain emotions and then use them in a way that you want to, so that your emotions serve you. Once you can distinguish between what is and what isn't in your control, and understand how to step outside of your emotions, you can really change the way that you see the world. Ironically, by understanding what you do not have control over, you give yourself more control. The Stoics held on to noble virtues that both determined a Stoic's path and enforced the important principles of Stoic practices. Great Stoics like Epictetus believed in having courage. They believed in seeking and using wisdom, and above all, they believed in doing the right thing. Marcus Aurelius said that justice is the source of all other virtues. Now, if you don't know where to go, start with justice. What is just for you, your family, and maybe everyone? How can you seek justice, even if that means admitting your own defeat or making a sacrifice? Well, let's go over a little example that ties all the ideas and practices of Stoicism together. You find a lost dog on the street and you take him home with you for the night. Now, the dog is adorable. You absolutely fall in love with him. You immediately want to keep him for yourself. Within a few days, however, you see that the owner of the dog has been posting lost dog signs all around your neighborhood. You're left with a decision. Do you surrender the dog back to its owner, even though you really love the dog, or do you keep him? Seeking justice and returning the dog to its true owner is not an easy thing to do. But you can ease the pain of giving up the dog by stepping outside of the negative emotions and viewing the situation objectively. Is this the last dog that you'll ever have the chance to own? Probably not. Can you go to a shelter and find a dog just as lovely as the one you found? Probably. Is it right to keep your neighbor, who has cared for the dog its entire life, worrying about their lost pet? No. Even though it initially hurts, doing the right thing should prevail. Now, you cannot control that your neighbor lost their dog, but you can control whether or not you unite the two. Moving forward, I want to talk a little bit about the modern influences of Stoicism. So when you hear some of these quotes from the first Stoics, you're likely to find yourself agreeing. What the Stoics say isn't radical or even particularly challenging. Some say it's just common sense. Now, we can apply the principles of Stoicism to modern-day situations and decisions. And actually, one of the things that has influenced me on the topic of Stoicism is a class I recently took on Skillshare by Ali Abdaal. The course is called How to Be Happier, Stoicism Masterclass, and Ali does a fantastic job at explaining these Stoic ideas in short practical videos that I personally found very helpful. Skillshare actually sponsored this video, and if you don't know about them, they're an online learning platform with over 17,000 classes at the moment. And I just want to say the price point is, well, in my opinion, one of these classes is worth way more than the monthly fee they charge. A premium membership costs less than $10 per month if you pay annually. And actually, if you're interested, the first 1,000 people to click on the link in the description below will actually get a free trial of Skillshare Premium. Now, I've been using Skillshare for almost 2 years now to have immediate access to experts on certain topics, and it's my first go-to platform whenever I want to learn something new. I highly recommend the Stoicism class taught by YouTube's own Ali Abdaal on Skillshare. Again, only the first 1,000 people to join with the link in the description will get a free trial. Let's move on to big idea number 3. Stoicism also shows up in modern approaches to psychology and therapy. In the 1970s, Aaron T. Beck began to build the foundation of cognitive therapy and cognitive behavioral therapy. These are techniques that psychiatrists use with patients today to treat symptoms of depression and anxiety. Beck actually stated that the philosophy of cognitive therapy can be traced back to Stoic philosophy, which I think is really cool. See, cognitive behavioral therapy is an approach that looks at the way that patients perceive and judge the things that happen to them. Take, for example, a divorce. Divorce is just an event. A patient may perceive this event as evidence that they are a failure. They may tell themselves over and over again that they are not a good person, and that the event is the end of their world. The more they engage with these thoughts, the more depressed they are going to feel. This failure will slowly take over the way that they view dating, parenting, making friends, and every aspect of their life. But what if there was another way to look at it? What if the patient could learn to step outside of their perceptions and see the event in a different way? Now, there are plenty of people who have walked out of a divorce course and rejoiced. For some people, divorce can be an opportunity to regain their happiness. It's not a failure, but simply a chapter in your life. Instead of focusing on what went wrong, you can use what you have learned and use it to be a better parent, a better partner, and maybe even a better friend. Doesn't the second approach feel more positive and productive? Well, both perceptions are entirely possible. You may even know some people who have these different views. These perceptions are within our own control. And that's what CBT, Cognitive Behavioral Therapy, which is based in Stoic philosophy, teaches us. Ending this video, I want to leave with one of my favorite quotes. Epictetus once said, "It is not the events that upset us, but our judgments about the events." Thank you guys so much for watching this video, and also don't forget to check out Skillshare if you haven't already. The first 1,000 people to click the link below in the description will get a Skillshare Premium free trial. I'll see you in the next video.